in some unrestricted funding, which has meant we've actually got a few new things in the building that haven't come from scheduling, and also been able to offer some trips for the kids. Through doing that, we've now started working with Magenta Housing as well, doing the same offering. We actually hosted a showcase event here in the town hall a few weeks ago and invited local businesses and local community members that had an interest in what NEO have been doing to look at how we can enhance what they're doing, they can enhance what we're doing. And that went really well, and we managed to get a Guardian reporter here as well to lead the afternoon, who has helped again sort of shouting about NEO and what it's doing to gain more support. From that event, we've actually now started working with Cllr this week, which we've had to put a tender in for some catering. And obviously it's corporate social responsibility at the same time getting what they need. So we're now feeding all the voting with vote builders every lunchtime, and that will bring in firstly a revenue to also what we're hoping to do is employ two local people to run that. We're given 8 weeks of getting a wage bucket there, and then we'll be looking at taking on staff. What we've also had massive support with is from Tramway Rovers through the ILM project for the council. Colin is one of the young lads that's been gone right the way through the sort of into the door through the social supermarket to now a full-time member of the NEO staff on a 13-month contract. But that has been the big headache of all the paperwork, as we are quite a small team, has been taken by Tramway Rovers for us, and he's seconded back to us. And that's to sort and help with all the food, help with keeping the building going, but more importantly, helping and supporting schools with breakfast clubs. We do buy food over the fair share, but what we also do is intercept food from supermarkets. That's growing and growing daily. It's not just supermarkets, it's restaurants, it's cafes, it's wholesale. And we're now intercepting, we have intercepted today, in the last 2 years, 67 tonnes of food, and we've wasted 2.5 tonnes of it. And that is waste when, you know, shops do give you big sacks of potatoes that a couple need to be wasted, things like that. We really do try not to waste. And he's doing that, and he's doing his peddler's course through Involve North West to be able to run a training course now from Brandon Street for young adults and adults wanting to return back into employment, giving them some work-based experience in warehousing, manual handling, food hygiene, and hopefully looking for jobs. That brings me on to Brandon Street. We've began to work with Pierhead Housing. We've got some buildings at the side of the town hall that haven't been used for 5 or 6 years. We went to see if we could use one to store some food. As always, NEO don't do things in halves. So by the time we'd left, we had 5 sets of keys for 5 units. And in the next couple of weeks, the training facility will be open. There's 15 people signed up ready to do that qualification, with Cisco supporting that for free as well, some extra qualifications. We're opening a community boutique, which is open to everyone. It's us secured an anchor tenant for Beaconsfield as well, which has been very important in the foundation years trust. We haven't got, it's not a massive building, we can't, you know, it'd be all well and good if we just make every building upstairs into offices, it'd be really easy to pay for and run, but where's the community space gone then? So they use one room as an office, and they're going to be giving a donation for that space, and in turn also offering free provision for 0 to 5s within the building as well. We've also just got Crosby Training, working with us now from the Beaconsfield Centre, offering a feeling better about yourself course through the Job Centre. Today was the first day of the course of 26 people, adults over the age of 32, have signed up to that programme for the next 6 weeks. We also, one of the units on Brandon Street is going to be used in conjunction with ourselves in the daytime for veterans with the AMO project. And they do a lot of work with giving out fitness passes, working with post-traumatic stress and supporting very vulnerable veterans that are in the area. And the Wirral Homeless Angels are going to be working with us in the evenings, early evenings there, to return some dignity to giving out food and being able to have somewhere safe to sit and enjoy their dinners. It's become a big problem every meeting we've gone to about the numbers that are continuing to grow that community group are feeding. And we've recently just been awarded the Wirral Awards to Neo and the volunteers, which is obviously an amazing honour. And also yet another platform to scream and shout and grab some support for Neo. So.
Working throughout else in there, because Oxton is going to be obviously a big part of this. And then they won the whole in-bloom competition last year. And Williamson Argyle, we also have got a courtyard garden that's going to be entered. And then there'll be an award ceremony that will take place in October. So hopefully we'll sweep the board again like last year. And there's also updates from all the food hubs that the constituency committee have invested funds in previously, just to show that they're still developing and expanding. And we are looking at expanding on the holiday food provision, and that's something we've been talking about today. And that's what we'll be updating at the next committee. We can't actually not mention the Hive, which is opening on the 8th of April. Gina, I don't know if you want to update at all. They are going to come to our next meeting on the 22nd of June to give us a full update. But we've provided some leaflets that Gina's got from the Hive, and you can give an update.
Yeah, as you say, the first of the grand openings is going to be on the 8th of April, and that's for young people. They've already signed up. Certainly, I know they've got 500 signed up, probably 500 in the waiting. But they've been doing a huge amount of work with young people for over a year now, all over Wirral. And what's really pleasing for me is that it's a real mixed bag. It's not all from one area, although obviously I imagine that a lot of them are from central Birkenhead because it's the easiest to get there. But it's certainly not mainly from Birkenhead. It's a wide range of young people from all over Wirral. Having a really great night tomorrow night, that big band night. They've been inviting loads of young people in. So there's 10 bands, all from Wirral. So I think it's going to be very noisy, so don't be yeah. It's absolutely amazing. We've had several tours with most councils going around, and everybody that goes is just blown away by not just the size of it, the range of activities, the range of support that's available, but the sheer quality of everything as well, including the staff that they've hired. They're really first-class people, and they're just so, up is the only word I can say. You know, you couldn't be down and fed up and go in there, and all of a sudden, you know, you're just really happy when you come out. So, perfect place for young people. And I just can't wait to see it open and see it absolutely, you know, the Hive buzzing with young people. No doubt we'll have a series of young people come and talk to the committee to say what they've done and how they feel about it.
Yeah.
I think that'd be a good idea.
We'll do that for the next one. The Great British Door Knock took place Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday this week in Rockbury. Where would you want to end, Chris? Chris and Moira were a big part of it, and
Billy.
And Billy and the connectors as well.
It was hugely successful. I'm afraid I didn't bring the stats with us, but I think it resulted in 200 something
to
180 odd referrals. So it wasn't really really helpful. And we did identify groups, I think all of us did, that were isolated from individuals who English wasn't their first language, which we haven't really got our heads around that. What help and support we might be needed for that. But it was a very useful exercise, wasn't it, Chris?
Yeah,
and very well supported. In the UK, we're very prominent in
and the Salvation Army.
And the Salvation Army. It was really good.
They provided the big participants. Yeah, it was really good.
Just on a point though, when I was at the second day, what comes across is the amount of people, which is a bit worrying, that when we ask them all different questions, when it comes to fire alarms, and not had the fire alarms updated for years and years.
And
I've got 10 in one close, and that's a lot. You reflect that across the borough.
Yeah.
And I know the fire brigade are doing a lot of publicity.
That
was worrying me.
Yeah, it was really good. Was they actually went and fitted the alarms on the day, didn't they?
Yeah.
They went out on the same day.
It was really good.
Yeah.
Went and fitted the alarms, didn't
they? Yeah. Well, we're going to have a series of clean-ups in Rockbury. We've got Beechwood Day of Action tomorrow, which is the police landscape for clean-ups. But we'll be doing the same in Rockbury, and because then the fire units will come as well and do the smoke alarm testing and fitting. So we could start working through
it. It would be good to get into some of the private landlord places and see their residents who might make speed of which they there was one. We had their mobile numbers, we rang them and they were going out and doing that. It's really good.
Just a very short update, the Improving Life Chances Community Pilots, they went to the scrutiny committee last week, which Moira is the chair of. But just to very briefly in summary, there's three meetings that take place in Community Pilot Partnership members, and they take place in Beechwood and in the North End, which is Business and St James's, and also in Seacombe, and they're all about trying to address local issues and improve the life chances of young people in those areas and families. And the way we're doing it is based on the work of the Constituency Committee, which is using food hubs as a way of engaging people to promote other services. And so we're sort of quite a way into it now. We've had four different meetings over 6 months now, and we've got action plans in each area, and so we're developing those action plans, and a lot of them include the food hubs and the food hub activities, and also in bloom, and then bespoke things like trying to increase smoking cessation in those particular community areas, increase volunteering, working with the connectors who presented tonight. So it's quite intensive, and we're trying to measure the impact, and then successful models of delivery, and then rolling them out to other areas in across Wirral. So that's just a quick update on that. The only other thing is, which has really been very successful, but which I think it'd be great to report back, and I might be able to do this, is the ASB project in Thorpe Road. It's been going on since February. Three sessions in Thorpe Road, but also wider, isn't it, across the North End, in Ilchester Square, and in St James' Centre, the Eden Bus as well, which is an outreach bus. But now there's, every day there's activity in the North End. Brian, I don't know if Anne or Brian wants to update about it.
I don't mind. So say we've got two young people working now at Walker Road Community Centre through the ILN project now. What we're hoping to try and do is to get them further funded, because they're only funded for a very short period of time. Last summer we had some major issues with ASB in the North End, really major issues. A lot of resources have gone in, a lot of work from our youth service, and these two young people have been engaged now. I think, and Brian, I went to the opening night, but I think you did a jubilee, and I believe that there were, you know, upwards of 20 to 40 young people, and they're not only engaged in activities, but they were fed as well. You know, the upshot of it was that they all had a meal at the end of the evening, and that, you know, they really are engaging young people. I think ASB, the stats show that ASB in the North End is at its lowest level than it has been for years.
So from 15 to 50, which is a significant reduction.
Just briefly add to that, I went to the sort of initial evening with a lot of young people a few weeks ago. There was about 50 people turned up. They were doing everything, five-a-side, nail painting, everything. But what really struck me, there was a few young people there that night who actually admitted that if they weren't there that night, they would have been out on the streets, probably throwing stones at cars, etc. And I mean, to me, that summed up the value of it. Everybody there that night was engaged, there was no trouble at all. Everybody was meeting with everybody else. It was fantastic, and it really was great to see. And as I say, people there were saying, if we weren't here, we'd be outside, we'd be in trouble.
Yes, made
a major difference. Yeah, it did. I just hope we can get a funding for the two ILMs.
Well, that's what we're
saying.
Group, the cohort on Wirral that they're aiming at is 38,000 people in their group, their target group. And So the audience out there is another 34,000 people that Hive can target. So it's not, shouldn't be seen as a threat or as anything. And what made me really proud was that, you know, we read all the time, don't we, about austerity and doom and gloom, and people within Wirral Council, and I will name one individual at the end, have had the gumption to say, well, defy all that, we'll get together and put something together that is fantastic, that is new, that is groundbreaking, and despite all of the brickbats and everything that's gone on, people have had the driving force to do that. I would like to, as the leader of the council, picked out a full council. I'd like it, Minister Jean, your personal contribution. There's not many members of the public. If they haven't been there, or your young people that you know haven't been there, please go and have a look and engage with it, because it is something to be quite proud of.
Can I just say something, George? I think also one of the things, I think I've heard it so often over a number of years now, but I've been working with Onside, who are the developers, that they make a real effort to engage with other youth providers that's going on around the Wirral. And they don't want to be seen as trying to displace or replace the work that other groups are doing, because Stuart, who's the CEO of the Hive, in another life, he was the manager of a small youth club in Bolton, and that's where Onside began, with the Bolton Lads and Girls Club, about, was it 15, 20 years ago. What they did in there, they made sure that they worked with all smaller youth clubs all around, same suspicions, same things they're trying to put us out of business. And actually, it's not about the clubs, it's about the children, making sure that they get the best out and the most there is to that are there. But what got me was the, I thought it was fantastic. They had a kind of informal forum in the end. So all the other youth clubs all come together at the Hive, and they'd work all together. They'd bid for things, anything, activities, funding out there, and then they'd come together as a forum and say, well, who's best placed to deliver this particular thing? Well, you do that, and you do that. So it becomes so successful that the forum is now formalised, and they all work together in that area. So who benefits? The children. And it just works. And I'd love to see that happen in Wirral as well.
I had a question last year, and I've known Larry Dave quite a lot. Birkenhead Boys Club, they're a big bibby centre. Where does that fit with the Hive? It's very close proximity to it.
Well, Peter Bibby was one of the first ones involved with. Yeah. Well, he's happy. He's going to work like that.
Very
and
happy.
The reason why they've only got one football pitch, like in Wigan, I think they've got four football pitches. Well, they've done the homework and worked with all, because you know this football is big in the town. We've got the Shaftesbury's, we've got the Birkenhead Youth Club. Mm. So they don't need any more pitches, so they've just got to kick about a five-a-side pitch as part of the offer of the whole time, which is fine. So they don't want to replace what's already there. Let's all work together.
It worked really well with our project, the Scouts and the Guides, that I'm all involved with, and we've all been up there using the activity. And with the Birkenhead Boys, we work with both, and they are really good work with us. They make sure that where Ann's have her youth club running for the kiddies on a Tuesday and Thursday, they're on a Wednesday for the younger ones that are normally allowed to youth clubs, so they've been really good working with them.
Yeah, so
onwards and upwards. Absolutely superb facilities, what we need to do is make sure we get the message out, as Steve quite rightly said, to all those thousands of people to make sure that people use it. Tony?
George, on another subject, I was just looking at maybe introducing, or if there's anything there already. It's about the look of our public buildings, really, the outside of them, you know, and I've just noticed going around the area and whatnot,
just ask people to can you look at the rubbish that constantly accumulates on Bulls Road? I mean, Bulls Road, I think it's Bulls Road, it stops at the Turner Street car park.
Yeah.
I mean, many councillors come together in Turner Street car park for political campaigns. I mean, I personally have cleared that top of that site three times with volunteers from Oxford, but we just need to find a permanent solution. I don't know what it is, but most of it seems to come down the alleyways from the local residents. But we need to find a permanent solution because it's just as bad as it ever was now.
Especially with it being an old alleyway. It does. Okay.
I did wonder if Councillor Foulkes knew the answer to that one, but have you read the last question?
I've got an answer, yeah.
Okay.
I mean, the first part of the question, yeah, we do pay as part of our levy to Merseytravel a large amount of money from the coffers, and the, as you know, free travel is one of the best schemes in the country. Including rail as well as buses, which is not the case in many parts of the country. Your specific question around railway stations, I only got the question late on, and it's not a very full answer, but it is an answer. I've been in contact with Wayne Menzies, who is the head of rail for Merseytravel, and what I've done, I've sent this email to Joe. I haven't got your direct email address, Joe, but you can pass it on to you. But effectively, what he says is, generally speaking, the responsibility lies with the station operator, noting that the Equality Act of 2010 requires all station operators to take reasonable steps to ensure that they do not discriminate against disabled people. The DfT Code of Practice, and there's a link below when you get the email, provides guidance to all station operators on the standards required so that they can continue to access their services. As part of train operating company's license, they must adhere to the standards set out in this code. So, and then there's another paragraph about referring to approved by the Office of Rail and Road, OR, and the DPPP, which is the Disabled People's Protection Policy, and the operator must take that into consideration and the interests of older, specifically says older and disabled people using its services. So that in the round, and then the link gives you the what they're expected to do or reasonably expected to do. That's the officer's formal answer. Of course, as Merseytravel is the sort of coordinator and keeping Merseyside moving, it's in all our interest to make all our stations and all our transport services as accessible as possible to as many customers, because customers pay the fares, and that's income for not just the private operators, keeping Merseyside moving. So what tends to happen when we get together to do a project on a major project on a station, and I think a perfect example is that of Birkenhead North, we will then work together to get a cocktail of funding. So there was capital money from Merseytravel's capital budget going into that, there was some Network Rail money, and there was money from the Merseyrail. So by and large, the answer is it's Merseyrail as the operator's responsibility, but when we work together, some of all our parts is better. So we,
where we get it right, we get it very right, and some of the stations you've picked out aren't particularly right, and I think that there's more work to be done. So if that is a round of enough answer to that question.
I think there was a second part about the strike on a Grand National Day as well,
yeah,
which you haven't answered.
Well, the question reads, would you also like to comment on the reasons that have led Merseytravel to strike recently?
Sorry, Merseytravel.
Planned action? It said, would you like to comment? My simple answer would be no, I wouldn't. But the reality, and again, I'll try and be as brief as possible, that there's a dispute at the moment, and the dispute is directly between the employer, which is Merseytravel in this particular case, and the RMT union. And obviously, as part of the RMT union, they have links with the drivers' union, and they're connected to the strike. The evidence of the strike was, I guess, the need to replace the fleet of trains that we have on the Merseytravel line, and we're all familiar with it. They are the oldest, amongst the very oldest in existence on that type of rail. So many years ago, Merseytravel began to build up a fund to make this project possible, to actually replace a whole fleet of trains. They had to do that within certain criteria. One, we didn't want it to be such a project that would put the rail fares so high. Just another thing to say, the rail fares on Merseyside are amongst the lowest in the country, and long may that continue. So we didn't really want to rely on massive fare hikes to fund the project. And secondly, we weren't going to come back for more money from the council taxpayer via the levy. And for anyone who doesn't know, the levy this year was reduced by 10%, which has meant we can keep more of our services that we hold dear at Wirral by reducing the levy. Then had to go out to a competitive tender, and the tender documents, in discussion with many stakeholders and interested parties, were put together. And effectively it was to replace the new fleet with a modern new fleet that will last us hopefully another 40 odd years. And in many respects, what has happened is that the market has come back with a fleet of trains that is almost, it's a trendy word, but future-proofed, I think, is a phrase that's used. So the fleet of trains that we have come back. Not one of the tenderers that came back with trains that needed to have two people on board to operate safely. There's different phrases used. There's driver-controlled operation and driver-only operation. One of the clear guidances as part of the safety remit and risk assessment of the new fleet was that the person who, this has come from various cases, including a fatality locally at St. James's, one of the key recommendations from HSE was that whoever starts the train, which is always the driver, would be in control of opening and closing doors. That is a fairly clear recommendation. That doesn't mean you can't have another person on the train doing other duties. So, I think what has happened is that we've then completed that piece of work. We've accepted a tender from a Swiss company called Stadler. The trains, and I won't go into the details, but they are modern. There's many, many safety features gone beyond the remit that was originally asked, even to the point where these trains will have a skirt where one of the problems with Merseyrail is the gap between the platform and the train will have a skirt that runs around it. And going back to your earlier question about disabled access, we'll even have a sliding door that comes out that will allow people in wheelchairs and buggies and so on to get smoothly on and off the train. So that dreaded gap we've had for many years ago. But the nub of the dispute is that I think the RMT's position is that they, irrespective of who controls door open and closing the doors, the RMT's perspective is that they have made a clear demand that they want a safety orientated, maybe not the wrong way, but a safety critical, I think they're saying, a safety critical person on the train at the same time as the driver at all times. The bit that sort of come out of what was affordable for us and was then endorsed by wanted an absolute guarantee from Merseytravel that nobody would forcibly be put out of work as a result of this, any changes that come in the future. That was agreed and been endorsed, and that's as far as we could go reasonably as Merseytravel, not the employer. We're not the employer of the guards. We're at the point now where there's obviously been a failure to agree the future strategy between Merseytravel and the RMT. My view is that really, and it's only my view because you've asked for comments, is that we are at a very early stage, and strike action at a very early stage is either good or bad, whichever side you want to be on in the argument. But the reality is that none of these trains will be anywhere near Merseyside for another 3 years or so. They've got to be built, they've got to be commissioned, and so on and so forth. So my view was that we probably could have been a lot more talks before we got to a point of strike action. But I've been a trade unionist myself. If your members are up for strike action, that's what takes place. So at the moment, I think the position is RMT are demanding, without any, as I understand, without any other conditions, two people on the train at all times. I think the view of Merseytravel is that is unreasonable given the technology that's involved with the trains, and the two have failed to meet. So I don't want to be accused of trying to influence the discussion between a bona fide trade union and its employer, and I think that will go on. It is regrettable that strike action has taken place, because not only because of the disruption to the public, but obviously individuals lose pay, which you know can ill afford, and strike action isn't an issue of last resort, as far as I'm concerned. So there is strong feelings on either side, but that is why we are at the position we are. We're at one day strike, as you know, and this next strike, obviously the maximum impact is held on Grand National Day, and that's the best I can do in terms of comments. I have sympathy for all parties involved, and I hope that they can get round the table and come to some sort of agreement. My advice would be that we look imaginatively about what that second person on the train would do in terms of income generation, perhaps, and the like. So at the moment, the guards more or less open and close the doors. They could go through the train, collect the tickets, and increase in income. The whole idea of the new train package, though, we had to do an economic assessment of what that would bring to the Merseyside area. If you have an efficient metro or train system like London, like Newcastle, like Paris, like all, it can in its own right create an economic benefit to the tune of over 10,000 jobs, was one of the figures quoted, over its lifetime, because it makes connectivity, makes the business system work. There will be jobs coming. We hope that Stadler will move one of its main offices here, but that isn't in the bag yet. And obviously the maintenance, particularly from Birkenhead view, one of the maintenance depots will be based at Birkenhead North. So it's not all doom and gloom, and part of the package did allow for a second person on the train, up to 67 employees dedicated to that role, particularly at times when people said in their surveys they were most vulnerable, such as late evenings and so on. All the stations as well, by the way, as part of this package, remain fully staffed, and nobody loses their job there. The ultimate goal, I think, for the RMT is to say, well, you've got a successful new fleet coming in. There should be more people using the system. There should be more profits. The RMT will be a share of that in terms of extra and extra security on the train. And I think that's the position we're at, John, if that a reasonable description of where we are. Okay?
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. That's your question. Right. Any other business, please?
Are we having questions from the general public tonight? Can we do that? All right.
that means 30 fees in the year. I'm promoting the gallery, doing the website and everything. And as I sent a message to Anne today, I've been shortlisted as World Tourism Star of the Year. And the Williamson and Priory Friends have been shortlisted as Volunteer Team of the Year. And we've also today found out that we've been shortlisted in two education programmes this year. So what we're doing as a very small team is quite successful. So I would hate to think that the Williamson, as it is under any kind of threat again, because we've been through that years ago. Okay, so I've not really formulated a question because I don't know all the discussions that are going on, but I know that there's some questions and things going around. So I don't necessarily need an answer.
Okay. I'd rather not give an answer.